Grace and mercy. It's good to be in worship with you this morning. Some announcements for you. If you have your connection card, remember to fill that out for our attendance rally because you get 2 points for your team if you have that filled out. And each family only has to fill out one. We just need to know everybody who is here on that, so not every individual has to fill out one. But if you want to do that, that's fine. It doesn't get you extra points, though. And if you're online, let us know that you're with us by saying hello on Facebook or giving a reaction to the feed there. That's the only way to know that you're watching. If you're watching on Facebook and you can't do that because you're not signed up for Facebook, you can send an email to the church office and you get counted that way. So some announcements for you this morning. You may have noticed in your bulletin that you have an insert. That insert's our congregational prayer for the youth director that we're searching for that we did last week together. I would encourage you to take that home, put it somewhere where you can see it. We're asking that everybody joins together for prayer on this until we find someone, until God opens that door and lets us know the right direction to go. And there were a couple of recommendations. One was that you pray at 4:45, whether that's a.m. if you're up that early, or p.m. when most of us are up at that time. Or you could pray especially on Wednesdays at 6:30 when the youth gather for youth group. We are focused on getting a lot of things done in the next 2 weeks while I'm on vacation. We were focused on getting so much done so that while I'm on vacation, everything was ready to go when I got back for charge conference and things like that. But we neglected to put in your bulletin and in the newsletter that tomorrow is Columbus Day and the church office will be closed. So if you need us, we're not in there. I'm going to be in Arkansas, or heading towards Arkansas, so you won't be able to get a hold of me. And by the way, as far as that goes, if you do need to get a hold of me, please reach out to the church staff. They will be able to get a hold of me more quickly, especially if it's an emergency. A reminder that we have a church conference coming up soon. Church conference is where we vote on business of the church, like leadership and membership roles and setting goals for the next year. I would encourage you, if you're a member, to come out to Liberty Chapel on October 24th at 4 p.m. That is when our church conference will be held. If you need a ride, please let the church office know. Hopefully by then I will have the shark bus cleaned for guests, in case you need a ride. We've also got a full calendar today alone. After worship, we'll have a short time of fellowship. More on that in a moment. Sunday school will be for all ages, and for those in the adult Bible study or adult youth pastors class, we're in Matthew chapter 4, and we get our first command today to study. So four chapters in, and that's when you finally hear from Jesus something that you're supposed to live out. So that's today. And then this evening at the Inches, John and Bev's, starting at 4:30, we're going to be having a bonfire and several other fall festival activities. You only need to bring a lawn chair. The food and the drinks are provided. So with that, we're ready for our attendance rally results from last week. And we're just going to skip straight ahead to it. Somebody asked me earlier which color is team one. It's red. So team one, virtual, was 17, 35 in person. You had 3 visitors last week. 3 in Sunday school, a total of 52 people and 93 points. Team 2, blue team, you had 7 virtual, 33 in person, 12 in Sunday school. You guys are knocking it out of the park on Sunday school attendance. 40 people total points is 85. You had 80 people in person, but when you add in the virtual, you had 104 last week with us in worship. That is awesome. So great job, everybody, with all of the work that you've been doing in helping to make attendance a habit and getting back into that at worship. Now, I believe the captains have something for us this morning. Is that right, Captain? So, Julie's coming up.
First of all, hey, Team 2. Woo! We've got a week to fill the pews, to pack the pews, and we can do it. A!
A!
U!
U!
M!
M!
C!
C!
Come worship with us!
Come worship with us! For today is found in Matthew chapter 13. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you for all the gifts you have given us, our lives, our loved ones, all that we have and all that we are. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus, your Son and our Redeemer, who came among us to show us the way to eternal life. Jesus was the perfect steward of your gifts, showing that complete trust in you is necessary and that giving of self is a most important part of following him. May the offerings of our time, our talents, and our material resources be made in the same spirit of sacrifice that Jesus taught us by his life, death on the cross, and resurrection. We pray all these things in his precious name. Amen. And now I invite you to stand if you're able and help sing the song of praise.
Thank you.
now we have a stewardship moment this morning with Gloria. Gloria Wagner.
Good morning. I wanted to speak to everybody about tithing, and if you're like me, it's just something that you do. You don't always realize why you do it or what the purpose of doing it is for. It's just something that you feel is your Christian duty and something that you just have always done. It's kind of just an automatic response. So I wanted to talk to you today about why tithing is important. Tithing is a regular reminder of our dependence on God. In good times, it's a reminder that God is the source of all of our blessings, and we demonstrate our gratitude for his care. In hard times, it motivates us to remember God's faithfulness and demonstrates trust in God to provide for all of our needs. Some scriptures that come to mind are Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, and Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 and 21. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust dust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart be also. One of the greatest blessings that I have in my life is my children, and I am grateful for that gift. And I want to do all that I can to honor God by taking care of my little blessings. When I tithe, I know that I am investing in God's future and in the future of my children in their spiritual walk. Whether it's helping to provide snacks for junior church and supplies for their class materials, or staffing who will help nurture and support my children and all of our children, our youth's spiritual growth and development is important. Helping to teach our future generations about God is why I give.
Thank you, Gloria. And as we're in this season, we have, you probably have received in the mail, because I've already received back quite a bit of envelopes this week that were sent to you with the reservation card, and perhaps you also included in there your estimate of giving cards. I haven't opened them. I'm letting others take care of that. But wanted you to know that those are the mail is working fine right now, and we're getting those in. But if you haven't done that yet, if you haven't received that yet, the Consecration Sunday reservation card lets us know how many folks are coming, so we have an estimate to let the caterers know how much food to prepare for Sunday the 24th. And the estimate of a giving card, whether you give that, send that in with that, and let us know that you're coming, but also go ahead and send us that information. That's great. Or if you send it in, give it to us on Consecration Sunday, that's fine as well. But we wanted to make sure those things were in front of you. This morning, as we worship, we gather for a time of joys and concerns, and I'd like to share with you a couple that I'm aware of. Given some praise to God this morning that the forecast looks dry the rest of the day. So that was Bev's request for our bonfire this evening. And I hope the rain was not too soaking this morning out your way. It surely sounded like it to us here. Also would ask that you pray for our family. We're going to be traveling all week. There's a couple of days where we'll be in the same spot about three times, but we're going to be traveling quite a bit. And then would you also continue to be in prayer for Jim Nicolin? At last report, he is still in the hospital with that infection that's getting treated with antibiotics. He's not there with huge breathing troubles, COVID kind of stuff. That's not the big concern. It's the other infection that's the biggest concern. But when I talked with Connie The good news is that they're thinking about sending him to a rehab facility to go to get out of the hospital. So that's good news, and he'll be closer to home that way. So be in prayer for him. Are there other joys and concerns to share this morning in the congregation?
We have a student at Delphus St. John's. His name is Drake. And a few weeks ago, he developed a bacterial infection that was a concern. But now, over the weekend, it's become even more of a concern, more life-threatening. So prayers for Drake. He's a junior high student, and his family.
So we lift Drake and his family up as they are dealing with the difficulties of an infection as well. I'm checking online here to see. I forgot to do this last week, and I apologize to those who are watching on Facebook. I'm usually really good at that. But last week, I missed that, and I apologize. Seeing lots of folks there on Facebook with us this morning, so it's good to see you in worship, but I don't see any prayer requests there. Scanning one more time.
They really want to say something.
They really want to say something, Mama says. Well, okay, boys, what is it?
Pray for the church.
Pray for the church? Well, let's do that.
Church is always fun.
Church is fun, yeah.
Pray for me because
oh, you're better. You've been better for 3 days now. All right. Let's quiet our hearts a moment as we go to God in prayer. God, our shepherd, you've been caring for us as your very own flock. You guide all things through Jesus, whom you have exalted as King over all creation. Hear the prayers we offered this morning in his name. We give you praise this morning for this body of believers, this group that is gathered that you call church. And we pray for our group here, for those who are watching online, for those who are worshiping in other gatherings. We pray for your church this morning, Lord. That the gospel would go out in many ways and many places, and that each life would represent the gospel in their communities and around the world, Jesus would be proclaimed. We pray, Lord, this morning and ask that you would continue to bless us with dry weather today, that we may be able to join together in fellowship this evening. We lift up to you Jim and Drake. As they struggle with infections in their body, we pray for the medical staff that is around them, offering them hope and healing. Let them be comfortable, Lord, and empower their bodies to fight back this infection, that they may return home and enjoy the presence of family and friends and happy days. Lord, we ask that you would look on us, that as we rejoice in your justice and your mercy today, that you would make our prayers reality in this life, that they would reveal Christ, his reign and his rule today, now, in our communities and in our world. Even at this moment, as we pray to you as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, I think we have a little treat coming up to join us and share in music.
ahead and show them our thank you.
The children's message, please. Good morning. It's good to see all of you here. Tell you what, I have a question. Oh, you need to sit, you can sit right there. There we go.
We have a lot more kids than we usually do.
We do have a lot more kids. Isn't that exciting? It is. Hey, I have a question for you guys. Have you ever heard of the TV show called The Price is Right?
Bruce?
You like the prices, right?
Beep, 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 beep.
Oh, all right. Beep, 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 beep. Well, you know what? It has been on for more than 50 years, this Price is Right show. And on it, contestants try to guess how much something costs. And the one who guesses closest to the price of the item without going over can win the prize. So that's pretty exciting stuff. And I thought it would be fun for us to play it today.
We can have that.
Yeah, so this is a bag of gummy bears. They're called Haribo gummy bears, and they're supposed to be the number one brand, as I understand. What do you guys think? Are they pretty good? Whoops, we'll put that in there. I don't know what that came from. Oh, it's your donut. Okay. All right. Yes, James. Well, let's listen to this story, and then you'll get to have some, okay? Does that sound like a deal? So anyway, what I want you to do is to try to guess the price of this bag of gummy bears, okay? Now, if you think the cost is more than $5, I'm sorry, more than $6, I want you to raise your hand. Do you think it's more than $6? Oh, it isn't. I'm sorry, you went over the price, so that means you're done guessing, but don't worry, there's still a prize for you. And how about $3? How many of you think the price of this bag of gummy bags is less than $3? Oh, that's too low. That's too low. So the price is somewhere between $3 and $6, okay? So I'm going to name some prices, and you raise your hand if you think it's the price. Do you think this could be $4? Some think $4. How about $4.50? Nope, not yet. How about $5? Yay, that's the right price, $5. All right. Now, that seems like a lot of money for this bag of gummy bears, but they're pretty yummy, right? You like them? Okay. It's a full bag with lots of little bags inside of it. You're right. Now listen, this is the important part about our lesson today, okay? You might be able to find these somewhere else cheaper than where I got them for $5, or maybe you could get a different brand that doesn't cost as much, right? But the question is, are they worth it? Are they worth the $5 that we paid for them? And every day, we have to make a choice about the value of things. We have to ask ourselves, how much are we willing to pay? Well, our focus scripture that I read this morning from Matthew is a story, Jesus telling us a story about a man who found a treasure hidden in a field. And he was so happy about this treasure that he immediately sold everything he had so he could buy this field and have this treasure. Now, what do you think Jesus was actually talking about? Well, it wasn't about the buried treasure in the field. He was talking about his kingdom here on earth and in heaven. Like the song, Build Your Kingdom Here, that we just sang a little bit ago. Cool song, huh? So having Jesus in our life, his salvation, giving us salvation and being part of his kingdom is the greatest treasure we could ever want. It's more precious than anything. That's why Jesus asks us to give all that we have to follow him. Is that too great a price? I don't know. I think the price is right for this precious gift, that's for sure. Can you pray with me, please? You repeat after me like Miss Kendra has you do, okay? Dear Father, nothing we have can compare to life with you and your salvation and being part of your kingdom in heaven and here on earth. Amen. Okay, now you guys have junior church, right? So I need someone who's responsible who can take these down with you to junior church and give them to Miss Kendra, and she'll make sure you have some if you're good in junior church, okay? Have a good time.
Listen, you are not responsible.
Verses 1 through 12. O Lord, remember in David's favor all the hardships he endured, how he swore to the Lord and vowed to the mighty one of Jacob, I will not enter my house or get into my bed. I will not give sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids until I find a place for the Lord, a dwelling place for the mighty one of Jacob. We heard of it in Ephrathah. We found it in the fields of Jar. Let us go to his dwelling place. Let us worship at his footstool. Rise up, O Lord, and go to your resting place, you and the ark of your might. Let your priests be clothed with righteousness, and let your faithful shout for joy. For your servant David's sake, do not turn away the face of your anointed one. The Lord swore to David in a sure oath from which he will not turn back. One of the sons of your body I will set on your throne, if your sons keep my covenant and my decrees that I shall teach them. Their sons also, forevermore, shall sit on your throne. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my resting place forever. Here I will reside, for I have desired it. I will abundantly bless its provisions. I will satisfy its poor with bread. Its priests I will clothe with salvation, and its faithful will shout for joy. There I will cause a horn to sprout up for David. I have prepared a lamp for my anointed one. His enemies I will clothe with disgrace, but on him his crown will gleam. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Cindy. Our liturgists really encourage me to proclaim the message each week. Each week before speaking, I spend time in scripture and reading and working with the text. So when it comes to Sunday morning, it's like a breath of fresh air to hear someone else read the text aloud. It's fun for me to hear the word, and it helps me to speak. So thank you, liturgists, and all those who join up here. In our hymnal, The Psalms are recorded in what is called the Psalter. It's a responsive dialogue between the leader and the congregation as we worship the Lord. In the reading of the Word today, I invite all of us to join together in the reading of this passage once again. So please stand as you're able, and it'll be on the screen as we join in the reading of the Word. We'll start with the sung response.
Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son.
O Lord, in David's favor, remember all the hardships he endured, how he swore to the Lord and vowed to the mighty one of Jacob. I will not give sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids. In Ephrathah. We found it in the fields of Jaar.
Let us go to his dwelling place. Let us worship as his footstool. Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son.
Rise up, O Lord, and go to your resting place, you and the ark of your might. Let your priests be clothed with righteousness. To David, a sure oath, and from it will not turn back.
Lord, the sons of your body, I will set on your throne.
If your sons keep my covenant and my testimonies, which I shall teach them,
if your sons also forever shall sit upon your throne. Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son.
For the Lord has chosen Zion and has desired it for God's habitation.
This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it.
I will abundantly bless its provisions. I will satisfy its poor with bread.
Its priests have clothed with salvation, and its faithful will shout for joy.
There I will make a horn to sprout for David. I have prepared a lamp for my anointed.
His enemies I will clothe with shame, but his crown will shine upon him. Hail to the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son.
You may be seated. So when you do something, when you want to do something, how do you do it? Are you impulsive? Do you just strike out from the start and take things as they come, not giving much consideration for a plan? Perhaps you are a planner. That's me. I like to consider my options and balance alternatives. When the issue is really big, I like to pray about it. I know many of you are prayer warriors out there too. We want to seek God's favor before we begin on any kind of venture. We want to make sure that we're on Christ's side with the choices that we make instead of trying to ask Christ to bless our mess after the fact. This October, we're wrestling with what it means to respond as hopeful people. We ask ourselves, for all that Christ has done for me, how will I give thanks in return? It might sound backwards, yet this passage is telling us that we have to start with thanksgiving. In our psalm today, David's life offers us an example of the importance of thanksgiving. He has a big plan to offer thanks to God. This is David's reason for bringing the Ark of the Covenant, the seat of God's presence with his people at that time, back to Jerusalem, to David's capital, and to build a house for the Lord there. This event is a both-and kind of circumstance. David is offering thanks for all that God has done for him. God is blessing him even more because of that as a result. David has been extremely blessed by God already to this point. 2 weeks ago, we studied the passage about how God protected him from lions and bears and empowered him to defeat Goliath. Later, David was saved by God from King Saul's murderous intent, and God made him king instead. In all of this, God used David over and over again to lead Israel to victory in battle, returning the Ark of the Covenant. Building a house is a thank you moment for David because he has been so greatly blessed by God. David is intent on returning God's favor as much as he possibly can. Yet in the process, God continues to bless David. We can be like David because thanksgiving clears a space for Christ in our lives. There's both a giving and receiving. We cannot outgive God, yet the more of our lives, and not just of our stuff, the more of us, our hearts, what truly is our lives, the more we give in thanksgiving of that to Jesus, the more space we open up for relationship with Christ. Verses 3 and 4 tell us how much David had and how much he was willing to let go of. It says, "I will not enter my house or get into my bed. I will not give sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids." David's house was a king's palace. It was made of cedar. It looked good. I imagine it probably smelled pretty good too. And because it was made of cedar, it was probably fairly pest-free, right? Now I know what you're thinking. With the change of seasons, you're wondering if you added cedar to your house, would that get rid of all these bugs that are coming in? Listen, David's house is nice, and he's ready to give that up and more. He declares, "I will not enter my house. I will not get into my bed, not give sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids." In the Psalms, the writers love to continually repeat the same concept in different ways. They join concepts together. They duplicate this in what's called couplets. Here we have four lines, two couplets, that all point to giving up comfort and rest. The very thing that God blessed David with, David is going to return in thanksgiving. God has provided David with comfort and rest. In return, David wants to create a resting place for God, and he will not rest until that happens. David is not trying to be deceptive here. He's not interested in getting more out of God, though that happens. If David was only seeking to better his position in Israel, this would have failed, much like an earlier attempt to bring the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem had failed, because it lacks reverence for God. Let's bring it to the modern day, because it's an easy concept. True thanksgiving enlarges Christ's lordship, not ours. If the tithes we return to God, the offerings we give, the multiple ways that we serve, all these things, if they're about us, making us feel good, bettering our position, bringing fame and comfort to ourselves, or if we're in it to be blessed more, it will fail. Because we're trying to buy something that cannot be bought. It's like we're hoping to bribe God into blessing us a little bit more. That's not how Thanksgiving works. It's not how blessings work. Our submission to Christ as Lord should be first and foremost when we give thanks. Do you remember what Jesus said in our word called worship this morning? Let's read it together. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. I believe Jesus is making the same point that David's example in this psalm is making. Is it worth everything? Is it worth everything to you? To David, it's worth everything to have God's presence with him, to honor God by building a temple, and again, to thank God for every blessing. The hope that Jesus offers us, hope restored, salvation in Christ, that's the treasure. Is that not worth everything to us? When Jesus tells the parable, sometimes we start to scratch our heads and try to figure out why the man just didn't take the treasure home with him. Why does he go and sell everything he has to go buy the field? What if the owner knew that the treasure was there and before the transaction takes place, goes and gets the treasure? We miss the point when we begin to analyze the parable that much. We've been offered the kingdom. You have found it. Or better said, Christ has found you, and the gift is yours. We want to be a part of the kingdom of God, to incorporate ourselves into the reign of Christ every day, placing our lives in Christ. In order to do this, you've got to clear that space so that Christ has a place to rule in your life. Jesus uses the figure of speech, sell all you have in order to receive that which is of inexpressible value. We continually prepare ourselves. Living in thanksgiving accomplishes this. In the Old Testament, the Ark of the Covenant and the temple are the places where God's presence resides, like in verses 13 and 14 of this psalm, the place where God desires to be. As New Testament Christians, we believe Jesus has changed this for us. With the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and the sending of the Holy Spirit, we are God's temple. And the Holy Spirit dwells within us, according to Paul in 1 Corinthians 3:16. Let's read that one together. You are God's temple. God's Spirit dwells in you. Before Christ, the temple was a building made of stone. In Christ, our hearts become the temple. Your heart and my heart, the temple of the Holy Spirit. The psalm continues in verse 10. For the sake of your servant David, do not turn away the face of your anointed one. This is pointing to David's zeal, forsaking comfort and rest in verses 3 and 4. It appeals to God's promises that are mentioned just in verse 11 next, and asks that God would fulfill those promises by not turning away. When people of hope give thanks, we offer ourselves to God's plan in Christ. Giving thanks means clearing a space. If something is important to me, if I am honestly thankful for it, I will sacrifice for it. A good example of this are the volunteers that have given their time and energy for Archbold's Park and Rec soccer community, the soccer league for the kids. The triplets have really enjoyed this over the past several weeks. These folks obviously love soccer, the kids, and our community. Enough, by the way, to get soaked a couple of times in the rain while a bunch of 4, 5, and 6-year-olds run around chasing a ball. For those of us who are working, when there's a family obligation, sometimes we sacrifice vacation time for the people that we love. That act, that expression of love, is also an act of thanksgiving for them. I love my sister-in-law. I am thankful for her, and when she got married back in July, I was 100% ready to be present and attend her wedding for her, and also for Emily, so that someone would be there to wrangle the triplets while she was up front. Little did we know that I would end up presiding in place of their pastor because she was hospitalized days before the wedding. When we clear the space in our lives, it opens up possibilities for Christ to work in our lives and in the lives of those around us. The future that Christ plans can be built in us. As we've been preparing for this worship service, Susie asked a pointed question. Is Jesus really at the center of the future we want? Think about it. Is King Jesus at the center of the future that you want? What was the condition of the vow God made to David? Let's read it again. If your sons keep my covenant and my testimonies, which I shall teach them, their sons also forever shall sit upon your throne. Did any of David's sons do a great job at this? I'd struggle to say that even a few of them did a decent job until you get to Christ. Jesus did it. Even David had his moments of failure being faithful. Yet in Christ, our faithfulness is empowered by his grace, and our failures are washed in his mercy. When we keep Jesus as King through thankfulness, faithfulness is a gift that he gives us. So why should this be important to us? During this month, we're seeking to respond in hope. First, Consecration Sunday is coming in 2 weeks, where we offer a portion of all that we receive from God back to him, to the church, for the ministry of Christ in our community and the world. We are now in the season to ask ourselves if Jesus is at the center of our giving. So in 2 weeks, we will receive those gifts through the estimate of giving cards. Secondly, that afternoon, we're going to gather with other United Methodists in our area for church and charge conferences. These conferences are where plans for next year's ministry are going to be solidified, the reviewing of membership, the naming of leaders, the setting of goals. The church conference is our opportunity to put Jesus in the middle of those plans. Then, over the next 4 or 5 months, we will begin be in the drafting stages for a strategic planning process. If Christ is not at the center of those plans, they will fail. Thankfulness helps us remain faithful. As we follow God's lead, we do this to assist in the mission and ministry of Archbold United Methodist Church, and most importantly, for the good and glory of King Jesus, our Lord, our Savior. Consecration Sunday, church conference, and creating a strategic plan are examples for us as a corporate body, all of us together. We also have to ask ourselves about our personal lives. So look at your outline this morning. As hopeful people, are we clearing a space for Christ? Does our hope puff us up, as in expanding our own good and our own glory? Or is our hope leading us to give thanks, to give ourselves more to Jesus Christ for the good and glory of Christ? Are we only thankful as far as God's plan matches our plan? Or is our thankfulness about offering ourselves wholly and completely to God's plan? Do our acts of thanksgiving lead us into deeper faithfulness? When we ask these questions, we'll discover that when we're truly thankful, For all of our hope in Christ, it is worth everything to us. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for bringing us together today to join with other believers that we might be encouraged in our walk with you. We do not deserve your goodness to us, yet we are hopeless without you. Thank you for giving us hope. Hope for today. Hope for this life. For forever. Our request is simple, Lord. Please help us to be thankful so that we might grow in our faithfulness to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
As we continue to offer our lives in thanksgiving to the Lord, I would invite the ushers to come serve us as we give back to God his tithes and our offerings.
Let's pray. God of the cosmos and God of every heartbeat, your work touches every corner of creation. Yet, when times are hard, we wonder if you've deserted us and we've become tight-fisted and fearful that sharing with others will leave us empty-handed. As we bring these gifts to your altar, give us the eyes to see and the hearts to know that you never desert us and never send us away in need. In the name of your Son, who came to remind us of your closeness and to give his life so that ours might be eternal. Amen.
Thank you.
join together as we pray our closing prayer. Jesus, as you said we would do greater things, we pray that we might be strengthened by your Spirit to do something so big that if you're not in it, we fail. Amen. May we, as faithful people, people of hope, be shown in our daily lives the hope that we have, that we may be a source of encouragement to others. Amen.
Believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God.